Iyanla Vanzant, we are so blessed to have you here with us today on The Grio. I want to start, dear, with something that we share, which is that we are both attorneys by trade. You are a lawyer, you have a legal background. And as women in the law, Iyanla, do you believe that that legal lens informs our perspective and the way we show up in the world as women?
Oh, absolutely. And that's why I got out. very masculine, very intellectual, almost stripped and robbed of humanity. It really shows the dichotomy between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. For me, it just didn't feed my soul. And so I had to get out.
I feel that. And I do feel that I might have heard on a date or two, Iyanla, that we are not in a courtroom, Eboni. You can put the gavel down. And I do feel it can spill over into the way I show up in my womanhood, which is really the center of this conversation today, Iyanla. We want to discuss masculine energy, feminine energy. I do want to start with kind of a news framing, which is that women's rights across the country, especially Black women's rights, they're under attack. Lots of laws are banning abortions. They are regulating what we can and cannot do with our bodies. What do you think happens for Black women when this type of siege is at play and we don't feel we have anyone to protect us?
Right. Well, the first thing I think we do is we go into anger. We go into anger without a clear ask. Doesn't make sense to be angry unless you've got to ask, you know, what is it that you're asking for? People can say anything in the world, but that doesn't mean that they get a right to do it. It doesn't mean that they get a right to affect you. But because so many of us are programmed and conditioned and educated to think like men, we respond like men. And when I mean men, I don't mean two-legged beasts. I mean in the masculine energy, and it becomes competitive, it becomes aggressive, it becomes againstness. And that's not who we are as women. It just isn't. And I think for Black women, particularly for us, the way that we've been programmed and conditioned and educated in the society to expect less, to accept less, to be angry and to complain, but to not really step into our authentic self, our authentic power as women, and create what we want, even if that's create the demand. Oh, no, not here, not today.
Okay, I hear you articulating, Iyanla, this masculine energy traits, the competitiveness, the assertiveness. Tell me how you would frame feminine traits. Aggressive.
Okay. Aggressive, not assertive. It's okay for a woman to be assertive. Grace, first of all. I think we've lost our grace. We move in such a harsh and hard way. Grace, compassion, nurturing, nourishing, elegance. How about majesty? How about divinity? How about holiness? This is not a language you hear coming out of most women's mouths, but they'll talk about being a boss, being a diva, being, you know, in charge. And many of us are either not seated in our throne as queens, or we're in the throne and the crown is crooked, meaning we're in the throne and we don't really know how to hold that place without the masculine aggressiveness and demanding and attachment. And it's killing us. It really is.
So in a recent interview with our dear friends over at The Breakfast Club, that went very viral for very good reason, you said that women are being trained to be men in skirts. I will acknowledge, I will say I was triggered. I was a hit dog and I holla to the entire production team to get you here today, because I actually think you're right. I think you're right, Iyanla. I do think that... I'll just speak for myself vulnerably. When I think of a masculine posture and what I would expect a man to do in my life, two things come top of mind, and they are provide and they are protect. And when my lived experience, and I think I'm still relatively young, I guess, but I'm 40 in September. So, you know, I've had some relationships. And I've yet to find a man who has shown up, and this includes even my father, who was absent. I've yet to have a male energy that provided or protected me consistently ever. So I think that I have taken on the reins to protect and provide for myself, because what I'm not going to do, Iyanla, is be without. Baby, it's not happening.
Be without what?
So that be would without be without protection, be without protection, okay. And be okay. Without the necessities of life.
Okay.
So, but I say that with an invitation, Iyanla, check me. Show me the error of my ways. Tell me how I might be missing it, because I might be.
Okay. I too am an alpha woman. So I understand what that means. And I tell people all the time, I was a horrible mother. I was a horrible mother. I was a great father. And I was a horrible mother because I'd never been mothered. So I didn't know how to affirm, how to nurture, how to nourish, how to guide. I knew how to direct, how to demand, how to discipline, and like you said, provide and protect. Those are masculine energies. And the distinction here is men build, women create. So we know how to build. We know how to get to the external and get the work done and drive and push and do it, do it, do it. We don't know how to be still, create it, and allow it to come to us. And I learned that when I lost everything. I learned how to create because I had already built and it all crumbled. The house, the husband, the job, the contracts, the professional career in the world, stripped of it all. All the attachments, the necessities of life, the creature comforts, until I was stripped down to the bare bone. And then I had to learn how not to build. Build is external. Create is internal. And we as women have the power to create and attract anything we desire. But we don't get still. We won't shut up. And we manage everything through fear, control, and survival, as opposed to feeling, knowing, and blooming or flourishing. Complete different thing. But since we've never been trained, we haven't been trained, we haven't been taught. So we do it the way we were taught to do it, which is very masculine in nature.
And very external. That's, I feel that you are describing me to a T, Ms. Iyanla. Now, is this why you are conducting a rites of passage program so that women, all of Black women in particular, can learn to create?
Women, so that we can learn our authentic power, that we can learn the distinction between a powerful woman and a woman in her power. There's a distinction, but there are skills and tools and practices and processes that we have to learn. At every age, the 20s have a process, the 30s have a process, the 40s have a 50s, 60s, we each have a process. And if you don't learn your 20 process, you're gonna be doing it at 50. If you don't complete your 30 process, you're going to be doing it at 60. And that means you'll be running on overdrive instead of seated in your power. Yes. And the secrets are there. They come from our culture. They come from our history. But no one has taught us. So me, as a descendant of Africans and Native Americans, I have a very lovely blend and mix. And I just, for a long time, I didn't do it because women in general, They don't want to hear. They think their way is right. And I'm crazy when I say, sit down, shut up, and listen, and you can create what you want. They don't want to hear that.
Well, I want to hear it. So tell me when the sign up is. I don't want to miss it. Let me know when you're taking registrations, because I am
right
curious. I had a very lovely single Black mother, and I'm going to get to the statistics on single Black motherhood and family life. But she was, by definition, more of a father figure in terms of providing and protecting. And I think that's very common. So according to the U.S. Census, Iyanla, 23% of households in the country are single-parent households, and we know 80% of them are led by women. How does this affect the child, both little girls, little boys, non-binary children? How does that frame their expectation of women when the mother is in charge?
It all depends on what the mother or the woman demonstrates about being a woman. if she's demonstrating that it's hard and it's rough and nobody's helping me and I got to do this and you got to do it this way, then that's what the children are going to get. If she's angry because she's alone, if she's desperate because if she's not conscious, if she's not careful. I mean, when I look at the damage that I did to my children, not being clear about who I am as a feminine expression of the chief architect and creator of the universe. When I understand that I didn't know that and how to tap into that and the damage I did to my children who I love with all my heart, as soon as I discovered how off I was, I confessed it to them and asked them to watch me as I rebuilt who I was. And I'm still very alpha, but I'm in my throne and my crown is straight.
Okay. I'm looking forward to straightening my crown, Dr. Iyanla. Let me ask you this. Let's get to the logistics, though. Let's get to the logistics. We know that Black women are earning college degrees faster than anybody else. Many of us are doing like we're doing, Iyanla. We're getting those terminal degrees, those JDs, MD, PhDs. We also are the fastest growing group of entrepreneurs, along with Latina women in America. Pew Research said that women are now out-earning men. Yes. In 22 of the largest cities in America, including where I live, New York, D.C., L.A., you name it. When we talk, and I know that you've said that you cannot teach a man or tell a man how to be a man, so I will not ask you to indict men in this question. But I do want you to speak, Iyanla, to how women need to, position ourselves so that we can be in our divinity, so we can have our crowns right, how we can create and not build, when some of us, quite frankly, feel that the men that are available to us, and I'm talking about across the color spectrum, across the age spectrum, trust me, I've done them all, they are not positioned to protect nor provide because of some of the statistics we just talked about. They're not earning the incomes. They're not having the resources, and some of them are not even showing up in the leadership.
Would you date a bus driver? You. Would you date
a bus driver? If he owns the bus. If he owns it. If he owns the bus.
See, that's a problem. That's a problem. Okay. Because the standards and requisites, and I'm not talking about him laying on his sofa playing video games all day. I'm not talking about that. But the standards and the criteria that we use to measure men is off for who we are as women and who they are in this society. I would date a bus driver if he loved driving the bus, if he was a man of integrity, if he was good to his mama, if he treated me well, I would date a bus driver. But we think that it's another human being's responsibility to give us what we need instead of us building together. I can build with a bus driver. I'd have my little stash over on the side in my prenup, but I could build with a bus driver. So I think some of the criteria that we look for in the reality of today keeps us unhappy, keeps us angry, keeps us imbalanced. And then when the men show up, we want to beat them up because they're not living up to our standards and criteria. And it's not working, beloved. It's just not working. So it's not that it's bad or wrong. It's obsolete. It's obsolete. We have to come up with a new way of being. I don't believe in carrying a man. A man has to do for himself. My son got his first job when he was nine. Nine. Okay? Because you're a Black man. You will know how to take care of yourself. But I think the way we measure it, it's just obsolete.
I think that's a factual analysis. For whatever we want, expect, we're told we were going to get, we got to look at the numbers and what's available on the marketplace. So you're certainly not wrong in the analysis. And Iyanla, let's tell the truth, the shame, the devil. We know what you got in that prenup would never be little. It'll never be small. Child, that's a big old mound of assets. But that's okay. Let's spend a little more time just so we're really clear in this conversation, Dr. Vanzant, difference between masculine energy and feminine energy, because I know that is not necessarily gender assigned, right? This is bigger than that. This is bigger than genitalia, right?
Right. Absolutely. When we talk about man is mind, woman is heart. And so many of us have guarded, broken, closeted hearts, that we do everything from here. And here, you know, as a woman that's been educated, that, like you said, has a degree, here will run out. Here will lie to you. This will never lie to you. But we've been taught not to trust this. We've been taught not to trust our knowing, our intuition. But a man can have a good idea and be brilliant, you know? So we want to have good ideas. But for us, our power is in knowing, and it's in getting that intuition and moving on it. That our power is in what we feel, not necessarily emotion, but what we feel in our body. But so many of us are out of touch with our body. We'll give our body to somebody else before we really get in touch with it ourselves, because we're so busy doing till we don't know how to be. When I talk about feminine energy, again, I'm talking about the grace, the compassion, the humanity. I'm talking about mercy. I'm talking about silence, stillness. I'm talking about flow and movement. I'm talking about speaking from a place of intuitive knowing, love. I'm not, and that's not the masculine way. The masculine way is justice, structure, power, it's control. That's masculine. Feminine is dominion, not control. But most of us, many of us, I'm in recovery, are control freaks. So it's a whole nother way, a whole nother vibe. She raises her hand. There's a whole nother vibe that we can tap into, that we have to tap into, because the world is dying. This society, this system is coming down. And if we don't step into our power as women, we're going down with it. With the fall of the materialism and the collapse of the systems and the structures, we got to. How many women do you know with degrees could live outside and survive for 3 days on the earth? How many do you know? I know I can. I know what to eat. I know where to find water. I'm not saying we got to go back to the rustic times or the wild wild west, but I'm saying being in contact and in touch with the earth in a way that empowers us.
Yeah.
Take the pants off. Take the pants off. Let your hoo-ha get some air.
A new definition to breathe again, huh, Iyanla? Listen, it's funny you say that. I only can survive the wilderness, and I know for sure, and I actually was able to do it for about 12 days because I was on a CBS reality show called Beyond the Edge that challenged me, though. It challenged me to do those things in a way I'd never done before. Before you leave us, I need to ask you about how what you're saying for women to sit in there knowing, be quiet for a minute, shut up and tune into our bodies, tune into our innate knowing, as I hear you say, but how that works alongside feminism, because you've said you're not knocking feminism. You're not saying women cannot be police officers, firefighters, play football or anything else. But you are saying that this hustle culture has given women a need to feel like we must be in competition with men. Is that
feminism for me? For feminism for me is a political or a social construct. And a woman, empowerment as a woman is an internal experience that becomes an external expression. I can be solid in my self as a woman. I may not want to play football or carry a gun on my hip. I may not. But the distinction is I'm not looking to anything outside of myself for my power, not. And I know that everything is coming to me to stretch, strengthen, grow me into my authentic and original being. And inside, I'm not guarded, I'm not harsh, I'm not brutal, I'm not violent. I'm not violent in my speaking. Women speaking today is so violent toward themselves and toward one another. So I'm not talking about a political construct, the women's movement.
Right.
I'm talking about the move of women for themselves, within themselves, so that they can be themselves in a completely different way.
It's internal. I hear you. One thing before you leave us, I have to ask one thing about dating. The reality is there are more men right now, Iyanla, on dating apps and seeking partnership than there even are women, contrary to popular belief. And a lot of men say that they're struggling, probably because of what you named earlier, probably because the expectations of many of the women are out of sync with what society is offering at this point in time, blah, 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 blah. How do women adjust our energy so that we are more successful when it comes to dating? If we're looking
to date. Well, do we just want to date or do we want to be partnered? That's one thing. Mm. If you have in your consciousness you want to date, you can date forever because you're going to find something wrong with everybody. But if you want to be partnered, my question is, what is your vision? What is it that you see for yourself, within yourself, about being in partnership? And are you willing to be in partnership as a woman, or do you want to be a dude having a relationship with a man? And when I say a dude, I mean how you manage yourself, how you talk to men. We got to stop talking to these men like they're boys. Even if he is driving the bus and he don't own it, or picking up trash, even if he did 7.5 to 15, that doesn't give us a right to use this divine instrument called a throat and a voice to demean somebody. But you know what? If we demean each other, we're going to demean our men. And we have to remember as women that while we, you know, you put a woman, she's got to feed the babies. So she's going to do what has to be done. We have a level of tenacity that many men haven't experienced, particularly men of color, because their genetic memory is that if they're too much, if they're too grown, if they're too big, if they're too smart, they're going to get hung. That's a genetic memory.
Yeah.
So we have to understand that who they are as men, I don't want to say is fragile or delicate, but it's more sensitive to our mouth. Mm. And our mouths are just... Our mouths are out of order. I'm sorry. With each other, but definitely with men. And I'm raising my hand. The only reason I can speak this is because I've lived it. And I knew how my life changed when I shifted from external masculine aggression to an internal knowing where I get my guidance and my direction. It's just different. And most women think it won't work in the world. But look at me. And there are hundreds of me. I'm not alone.
Yeah. Indeed. Iyanla Vanzant, just eye-opening. When I hear you talk and I hear the themes and even the tone, it's very Maya Angelou to me. I intended to be the high compliment that I believe you received it. And none of us are beyond growing and learning. So I deeply appreciate the exchange, and the wisdom. Final words to leave us with today.
My sister women. Not how we are is not bad or wrong. What we've done is not bad or wrong. What we've been taught or learned wasn't bad or wrong. Let us just consider that there's a greater possibility and another way to be.
Up for consideration. I'll put it under advisement, Dr. Vanzant.
Thank you.
I'll put it under advisement.
Well, I want to encourage you. Take it to heart. Take it to heart. Not put it under advisement. Take it to heart.
I know. I'm just kidding. No, I do. I do feel the possibilities of what could this look like in a different way. I feel that on a spiritual level. So thank you. Thank you for challenging that for many of us.